Well, we're going to be looking into the Gospel of John, chapter 13, this morning. And we'll particularly look at the 8th verse. We're going to share in the Lord's Supper, as you can see behind me. So we're getting into the message a little earlier today. So I want to share this passage with you out of John, chapter 13. Let's read it, and then we can set up everything that there is to say. All right? Start with verse 1. Before the Passover celebration, Jesus knew that his hour had come to leave this world and return to his Father. He had loved his disciples during his ministry on earth, and now he loved them to the very end. And here's how he does that. It was time for supper, and the devil had already prompted Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over everything, and that he had come from God and would return to God. So he got up from the table, took off his robe, wrapped a towel around his waist, and poured water into a basin. Then he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel he had around him. When Jesus came to Simon Peter, Peter said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus replied, "You don't understand now what I am doing, but someday you will." "No," Peter protested, "You will never, ever wash my feet." Jesus replied, "Unless I wash you, you won't belong to me." Simon Peter exclaimed, "Then wash my hands and head as well, not just my feet." Jesus replied, "A person who has bathed all over does not need to wash except for the feet to be entirely clean. And you disciples are clean, but not all of you, for Jesus knew who would betray him." That is what he meant when he said, "Not all of you are clean." Now, the reason I'm reading this section of John chapter 13 is because I would like you to put yourself in this picture. Try to imagine that you are among these disciples, and you are in a chair, and you watch Jesus do as we read. He takes off his robe, he wraps a towel around him, takes the basin of water, and one by one, he washes the feet. He does what a Gentile house slave would do. Never someone like the disciples or like Jesus. But the house slave would do this, and now Jesus is doing it for them. Imagine it. Imagine you're sitting there, and at your feet is Jesus, filled with holy love, the Son of God. Actually, God in human flesh is at your feet, washing your feet. What's going through your mind? How do you feel in that moment? What are you thinking? Are you feeling valued? Are you feeling humbled, loved? I hope maybe you're feeling really like recoiling and cringing. I don't know about you, but I would feel all of that, but in particular, I think I would feel exactly what Peter felt there in verse 8. I would feel like protesting. "No, not you. You can't do this for me. You're the Messiah. You're the great one, the promised one. I can't allow you to do this for me." That's the way Peter felt. I like the insight that one man by the name of Scott Grant. I like this insight. He says Peter doesn't understand what's happening. He can't accept the acceptance of Jesus. And why not? Look at this. Because love can be a terrifying thing. Love challenges every self-protective vessel in our bloodstream. We resist love to remain in control. Let me say that again. We resist love to remain in control. If we let love in, we give up control. Someone else now has influence over us. That's why it's so difficult to receive. It's much easier to give than to receive. That's very true, isn't it? It's always much easier to give than it is to receive. But notice in this text, in verse 8, Peter is protesting, but then Jesus, in effect, says to Peter, unless I wash you, you won't belong to me. And then Peter responds as if to say, I don't want anything coming between you and me. You do what you need to do because I want to be in your life and I want you in my life fully and completely. Now, I want to take this picture that I hope is in your mind at this point and let's put it in the background and just leave it hang there as I go through some other verses that are in effect different from what I said, but I want to bring it to a conclusion that is very similar to what we're seeing here in John 13, 8. What I'd like to show you, first of all, is something about this man of the New Testament, Paul the Apostle, very important to us. The Holy Spirit uses him to write 13 New Testament letters. And what I want you to see is something of the storyline of the life of Paul the Apostle, who, in case you didn't know, before he became a Christian, he was a strange and strong, at the same time, religious zealot. His name then was Saul of Tarsus. That was a name that literally caused many people to tremble in fear when they heard it. His attitude was one of burning hatred toward the person of Jesus Christ. There is no one, and I mean no one on this planet, who hated Jesus of Nazareth more than this guy, Saul of Tarsus. And of course, the reason he hated Jesus is because Jesus stood against everything Saul believed and held to as sacred. And here's the thing. I want you to hear this. It never occurred to Saul of Tarsus that he might be wrong about God. It never entered his mind that he might be wrong. I find that there's a lot of people today that you talk to about spiritual stuff and you try to offer them the truth right out of the New Testament and they won't budge. It never occurs to them that they could be wrong. I was brought up this way. This is what my parents taught me. How could it be wrong? Dr. Craig Barnes writes about this. He says, most of us can muster up enough humility to admit that we are not always right, but it's hardest to be wrong in our ideas about God. That's because, whether we realize it or not, our understanding of God is at the base of everything we believe. So if our understanding of God changes, everything else in life will have to change as well. He then says this. The inverse of this is also true. Sometimes you want to make a few changes in your life. Maybe you would like to be less stressed, less controlling, more patient. But you'll never succeed in changing until you see God differently. Change, or as we religious folk prefer, conversion, begins with your vision of God. And of course, he is exactly right. And when you think about it, this is really at the root of Saul's hatred of this man, Jesus of Nazareth. For him to embrace Jesus, that would mean a complete and dramatic change in all of his thinking and in all of his lifestyle. For example, think about the pathway of salvation. In other words, how is a person made right with God? Well, Saul spent his entire pre-Christian life believing and teaching that the only way to be right with God was by strict adherence to the Old Testament law of God revealed in the first five books of the Bible, the Pentateuch. You had to strictly adhere to the law of God, he thought, and in particular, the moral law of God codified in the Ten Commandments. You had to obey that and be good at that in order to be right with God. Paul was like a lot of people, even in our day. They saw God's law as a ladder that we use to climb up to God. You know, rung one, rung two, three, and you're being good and you're climbing up to God, but sooner or later, you're going to fall. Because the ladder of good works on your terms and through your effort is really impossible to climb. The truth is, the moral law of God is actually referred to in the Bible as a mirror. And you and I look into the mirror of God's law, and what we see reflected back is the fact that there is sin in our life. There is moral defilement. You could say that the moral law of God is like a spiritual CAT scan or a spiritual MRI. You know, those devices, you go through them and they reveal what's going on in you. And this law of God is like a spiritual CAT scan that reveals in us the moral defilement that we often don't see in ourselves. And so against Saul's way of thinking, and really it was also against the way that Israel as a people would think, against that, here comes Jesus of Nazareth. First of all, he's from the wrong side of the tracks. He's from Nazareth. He's a hillbilly. That's the way we would refer to him today. He doesn't talk the way that all of the sophisticates talk. He didn't go to advanced seminaries and schools. He didn't have any of that. And here he comes, Jesus of Nazareth, and his people are proclaiming him to be the true Messiah. And what's even worse is that this Jesus teaches a message that is based on God's grace alone, as opposed to and as against the law of God and the idea of religious rule-keeping. Remember something, if you would. When it comes to the message of God's grace, grace, by virtue of understanding it, as a definition, grace means that God always is the one who's doing the work. Under grace, God is always the giver, and you and I are always the receiver. If it isn't according to that pattern, then it isn't grace. And so when Saul hears these early Christians proclaiming Jesus Christ as the Messiah. And when they hear about this offer of saving grace, he is enraged. I mean enraged. Look at this in Acts 8:1. Saul was one of the witnesses, and he agreed completely with the killing of Stephen. He's the guy who gave his thumbs up, take his life. They stoned Stephen to death. And it was Paul who gave them permission, or Saul who gave them permission to do it. Notice, a great wave of persecution began that day, sweeping over the church in Jerusalem, and all the believers except the apostles were scattered through the regions of Judea and Samaria. In other words, they had to run for their very lives because of Saul. Look at verse 3. But Saul was going everywhere to destroy the church. He went from house to house, dragging out both men and women to throw them into prison. And then in chapter 9, as the story continues to develop, in verse 1, now Saul still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord. Now, I think you can easily see the rage, the hate that is in this man. It's very real. And by the way, let me show you another little glimpse into this man's life and his thinking. In Philippians 3:5, he writes what is, in effect, his pre-Christian religious resume. Look at this. He says, I was circumcised when I was 8 days old. I'm a pure-blooded citizen of Israel and a member of the tribe of Benjamin, one of the top two. A real Hebrew, if there ever was one. I was a member of the Pharisees who demand the strictest obedience to the Jewish law. I was so zealous that I harshly persecuted the church. And as for righteousness, I obeyed the law without fault. Notice what stands out in these two verses. He is saying, I did this, I did this. And in his mind, he's doing it all, why? For God. It never occurs to him again that he could be wrong. How about you? What are your views about God? What are your views about salvation? How to be made right with God? Are you sure your views are accurate? It never occurs to some people that they could be wrong about this. Saul is a guy who believes he's doing the right thing as he persecutes the Christian church. And so in this pattern, he hears again and again the preaching of Jesus. He is confronted with a message of God's grace, a message that says, in effect, you cannot work your way to God. Human merit, human achievement does not matter. It's religion, human-based religion. By the way, religion is man by his own efforts seeking to win the approval, the favor, the blessing of God. On the other hand, Christianity is about responding to God's love and grace as it's offered us in Christ. Religion is you doing something good for God. Christianity is God offering something great to you. And you respond to God's grace by faith. And of course, to go back to Saul, he hears that message. It stands against everything he believes and holds dear, and he recoils, just like a lot of religious people do in our day. I can tell you this. I've talked to people. I've been in the valley now for over 40 years, and there are some people that I have shared the gospel with. And I brought out Isaiah 64:6, which says, all of our righteousness is as filthy rags. And I have seen the blood drain out of people's head. I mean, they get infuriated to the point that some people almost want to fight because you tell them you cannot be saved by good works. It's not about being a good person on your terms. It's about something altogether different. And people, again, they just don't want to believe that they're wrong about God. Now, the question that we need to ask this morning is this, all right? What is it about the Christian message of salvation by grace alone? What is it about that message that is so threatening to a man like Saul of Tarsus that he's willing to kill people to get rid of that message? Or to put this in other terms, what's wrong with saying to people, you need to get to work being a good person? You need to start obeying the Ten Commandments and climb your way into the presence of God. You need to show God that you're sincere. You need to show God that you're worthy of being blessed, of having answers to your prayers. You need to show God that you're worthy of gaining entry into heaven. Now, what's wrong with that message? Well, here's the answer, folks. Number one is this. We have to understand that a religious-based belief system is, in fact, contrary to the very nature of God himself. And let me show you why I say that. In Acts chapter 17, Paul the Apostle is in the great city of Athens, Greece. He's in the marketplace, and he is proclaiming the gospel to all of the intellects, to the intellectuals of that day. And this is part of his message. He says, the God who made the world and all things in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all people life and breath and all things. Now, here's the deal. If God is not served by human hands as though he needed anything, if that's true, then why would someone like you or I, why would we think that we could serve God and thereby earn his blessing, his favor, or the gift of eternal salvation? Which, again, this was the mindset of Saul. He wrote this in Galatians 1. He says, you know what I was like when I followed the Jewish religion, how I violently persecuted God's church. I did my best to destroy it. I was far ahead of my fellow Jews in my zeal for the traditions of my ancestors. And so I think you can see very clearly he thinks he's right in destroying the church, in persecuting the church. Saul of Tarsus was a man whose whole identity was wrapped up in the idea of giving service to God on the basis of what he understood. His whole being, his whole identity was wrapped up in that context. Now, here's my summary at this particular point, all right? Two things. First is this, the true gospel of Jesus Christ is really bad news for people who are driven by self-effort religion. When they hear it, they recoil, like Peter before Jesus, like Saul when he heard the message of Jesus. When someone is into self-effort, self-help religion, the message of the gospel of grace is bad news. On the other hand, It's the very best news for people who are willing to stop trusting in themselves. To those people, Jesus says in Matthew 11:28, notice, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come to me, says Jesus. Notice he's talking about two kinds of people, and I think he's putting the human race into one of these two categories, those who are heavy laden. He has in view here those who are weighted down with the burden of sin. Oh, I saw someone that I know just recently. They're in that battle with heroin, and the weight is so on them. Their life is just withering away. They walk like they're 70 and they're only in their 30s. It's just unbelievable. To those who are heavy laden in other ways, Jesus says, come. To those who labor, those are the people who are on this religious treadmill, trying to be good enough, trying to earn the blessing, trying to earn the favor of God. And so Jesus says, all of you who labor and heavy laden, come to me and I will give you rest. By the way, it's interesting to me, if you read through the four Gospels, it's interesting to note the people, the kind of people that were attracted to Jesus and the kind of people that were repelled by him. The people who were attracted to him were people who were laboring and heavy laden. They were burdened by sin in their life. The woman at the well, others who the disciples, I mean, they were just broken by bad choices in their life, and Jesus receives them. On the other hand, those who were always fighting with Jesus were very different. They were the kind of people who were very caught up in themselves and self-effort, self-help type religious lives. That's the kind of life they live, and they didn't like Jesus. One thought here. When I think about our church here, Journey by Grace, I ask myself this question a lot. Are we attracting the kind of people that were attracted to Jesus? And are we rebuffing or the kind of people who are resisting us, are they the kind of people who resisted Jesus? We could ask that about ourselves individually. Are the kind of people that were attracted to Jesus, is this the kind of people that are attracted to me and my walk with God? Look at this again. In Acts 17:25, Paul says, God is not served by human hands as though he needed anything. He is not served by human hands, but he himself what? Gives. He himself gives to all people life, breath, and all things. He is not served by human hands, but he gives. Look at this text, if you would. Mark chapter 10, verse 45. Jesus said of himself, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many. And so why did Jesus come into this world? Well, he did not come to be served by human hands. He did not come to be served, which means then he did not come in need of us in any way, shape, or form. Yet his coming is in fact all about us because of our need. Our need to be delivered from the rule and the tyranny of sin. Our need to have ransom. Notice the text. It says, he came to give his life as a ransom. I think you know what a ransom is. A ransom is a payment made to gain the release of captives. And of course, the captives in this case are you and me. We are the captives that needed this ransom payment. Now, I'm sure there's someone here who's thinking, me, a captive? Come on, I'm not captive to anything. Well, I guarantee you're captive to three essential things. You are captive to sin, you are captive to Satan, and you are captive to death. We are all enslaved by those three realities: sin, Satan, and death. However, look at this. In Ephesians 1:7, Paul says, of God, he is so rich in kindness and grace that he purchased our freedom with the blood of his Son and forgave our sin. Notice, he purchased our freedom. In other words, he paid our sin debt with his own blood. Look at Peter chapter 1, verse 18. He says, for you know that God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors. And it was not paid with mere gold or silver, which lose their value. It was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. God chose him as your ransom long before the world began. But now in these last days, he has been revealed for your sake. Through Christ, and now this is true of every believer in this room, every Christian, through Christ you have come to trust in God, and you have placed your faith and hope in God because he raised Christ from the dead and gave him great glory. The resurrection is in effect God saying to the world, I accept what my Son accomplished in your behalf. Now you need to accept that. And as believers, that's what we have done. Now, let me suggest a way that we might see and understand this picture that I'm trying to create. Here's the deal. Jesus Christ goes to the cross as our substitute. And he is there doing what? Serving you. Serving me. Serving us. He is acting in our behalf. And I would also argue, based on all of New Testament scripture, that this pattern we're seeing right here of Jesus Christ there serving us, offering himself in our behalf, this is the pattern that we are to live in by faith as we execute the Christian life. The Christian way of life is all about letting Jesus Christ help us, doing something in our behalf, for us. In fact, every command of Scripture is really a clear reminder that we need Jesus to help us. Think about it. Let me show you a text. Hebrews 4:16. Let us come boldly to the throne of our gracious God. There we will receive his mercy and we will find grace to help us when we need it most. Look at this. Hebrews 13, don't love money. Be satisfied with what you have. For God has said, I will never fail you. I will never abandon you. So we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper, my helper. So I will have no fear. The Lord is my helper. You've heard me say this over the years, but I need to say it again and again. Christianity is not a help wanted sign. It's a help available sign. It's God saying, I will give you what you need. I will help you through this life. I will provide for you what you need so that you can live the overcoming life that I'm calling you to live. And really, this is the authentic Christian message, and I can tell you the reason it's so hard for some people is because it requires humility and it requires that we let go of control. Love in this package, you might say, is so threatening because when we give ourselves to love and receive love from God, it means we're losing control to Him. Let me read something to you here from Scott Grant. He wrote this. The love of Jesus is something else, something with which we are completely unfamiliar. It comes at us in the form of a vulnerable slave, risking all, exposing himself to betrayal for our sakes. The King of Glory washes our feet. He's telling us, you're welcome here. I receive you. I accept you. Many of us have heard God loves you and Jesus loves you so many times that it means little to us. We're insulated against its impact. Some of us find it easy to profess, Jesus loves me. But when that love takes the form of acceptance, in other words, accepting you as you are, as you really are, total acceptance. When that love takes the form of acceptance, some of us squirm. We can't imagine that love, His love, would go that far and accept us as we are. Our thinking may go something like this. God is love, so He loves. He has to love. Yes, Jesus loves me, but does He accept me? I know He loves me, but does He like me? The answer is at our feet. That's where Jesus is, receiving us. I wonder this morning, can you picture that at your feet? And is it possible that we can handle that kind of love? Can you let go of yourself and receive that kind of love and help? The Bible says that we are to humble ourselves before the mighty hand of God, and God will exalt us at the proper time. But it's something we have to do. Humble yourself, make yourself open and vulnerable, and you will be on the receiving end of a river of love like you've never dreamt possible. Let's have a prayer.